the block. About authentic people doing beautiful things. Enjoy the show.
Folks, this is your host Andy Gervich, sitting in the chaos that is modern America, the tail end of this 2016 election cycle, filled with all the nastiness being hurled at both campaigns, all of the ugly sexism coming from the Trump folks and from the Trump mouth himself, and from a lot of his supporters. I'm blown away at some things and. Don't know quite what to think. Sitting here in Portland, Oregon today, we have 60 mile an hour wind gusts. Many of my friends, their places are flooded from some recent rains, and I'm seeing a lot of natural chaos mirroring a lot of cultural and internal chaos, and a lot of it, a lot of systemic racism, a lot of systemic misogyny. In this this fear that dominant culture has of other, this fear that the radical individualists have of any kind of collective shared identity leading to a shared responsibility and a limit of one's personal power. What interesting times we live in, huh? I'm reminded of the Demeter and Persephone myth of Greek mythology. Demeter, the goddess of the grain, the goddess of the harvest, longing, walking for 9 days in mourning, looking for her daughter who had been kidnapped by Hades and brought to the underworld against her will, forced to eat the pomegranate seed. Zeus, hearing the cry of Demeter and helping her get her daughter back, but with the caveat that she spend a portion of the year in Hades. With her then husband. So much about this myth is, you know, spoken of in terms of this being the sort of Greek understanding of the changing of the seasons. And I've always been skeptical of that understanding of myth, is that this is just an actual explanation of why a particular group of people in a particular time thought something happened. I don't know if it's quite that simple. But it is a metaphor, at least for some things within that culture. And one of them might be this notion of seasonality and of change and of transformation and of tying that abundance and of that change and of that transformative energy, to the body, not only of Demeter, but of Persephone, her daughter. The other sort of ugly thing that myth brings to the conversation, is this, this kind of male control of women's bodies, not only Zeus, but also Hades. And I think at least since the Greek era, this is something all over the world, but definitely in the Western world as well, that we've been struggling with, is this this ownership of other. That which we aren't, that which we fear, is that which we're drawn to and we feel we must control, or maybe we feel if we don't, it will control us. I'm seeing a lot of hatred of women's bodies out there and a lot of misunderstanding and a lot of fear, but I'm also seeing a lot of conversations emerging from this, a lot of hope, a lot of people, you know, that are saying no more and are starting to tell their stories and are starting to come together and come alongside one another in real communal transformative power. And our guest this week, Dr. Catherine Svehla, is a cultural mythologist, a storyteller, an artist, and an activist who has a PhD in mythological studies. And she uses her knowledge of myth and of psychology to bring stories to life and to bring the story to life and share insights into the contemporary meaning of the tale and of narrative. She's a remarkable individual. A friend of ours and friend of the show, David Gonzalez, recommended that she come on. And although I'm speaking of some political issues here in the beginning, she's not, at least in our conversation, a particularly political person. We steer clear of, on this show of some of that stuff, but it's just the time of year to talk about a little some of these things. But as far as her work goes, she goes deeper into things, looking at how stories are the catalyst for conversation, group discussion, shared reflection, as a vehicle to teach us and provoke thoughts, as well as laughter, as we sort of go into ourselves. The revolution she's trying to run, participate in and sort of guide people in, is not so much one on the macro level, but maybe on the micro level, maybe a mini revolution of consciousness, she calls it, through the work she does with her project Mythic Mojo. So we talk about that in the conversation, and you can get over to our site and hers to look into that. But what do we mean by a revolution in consciousness, right? She's going to be helping individuals explore the mythic dimensions in their own lives. And so how do these archaic stories come to shape our own frame of consciousness? But more importantly, how can we engage them in ways that are unique to our own creativity, our own expression, our own identity, and use them for vehicles of our own power and our own creative expression? So it was a delight to speak with her. You know, we have a little bit of sanity in this very turbulent and chaotic world at the moment, and we have to get a little bit of respite with Dr. Catherine Svehla. It was a great conversation, wide-ranging. We thank you for the guest recommendations, folks. Like I said, David Gonzalez recommended her, and she just did a wonderful job on the show. Get over to the site, as I said, to check out the work she's doing if you want to contact her for any of that. All right, folks, sit back and enjoy the program. And if you're in the Northwest or any of the areas that are being hard hit, our prayers and good energy are with you, and we hope that you're safe this time of year. It's turbulent out there as well. I'm always interested when the internal and external come together and sort of match one another, and it feels like that's what's going on in the weather out there, and that's what's going on with a lot of folks in terms of their interaction with this culture as well. And speaking of that, all solidarity with Amy Goodman and Democracy Now! As she faces charges for coming alongside of the folks at Standing Rock and covering that story when other journalists wouldn't. All right, enjoy the program, folks. We'll see you on the other side.
Sleep until the morning comes. The sun.
right, welcome to the show, folks. This is your host, Andy Gervich, and our guest this week is Dr. Catherine Svehla. And before we started the show, you said, I'm interested where this is going to go. You're interested to know what I know about you. And so let's start there with what I know about you. I know that you run a website called Mythic Mojo, that you do mythological study groups in the Mojave Desert, and that you're a host of your own podcast on mythology. I know that you are also a mythic and a professional mythic storyteller. And these are the things I know about you. And then I know you come highly recommended from a friend of mine and a friend of the show, who was like our second or third guest way back when we started, Mr. David Gonzalez, who is, among other things, a wonderful mythologist. And I call him a griot, but he gets mad when I say that. But he's definitely a wonderful, wonderful individual and a Joseph Campbell fellow, among other things. So welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm really pleased to be here. And David was the contact. Actually, I met him fairly recently, but it was in comparing notes on our approach to mythology and storytelling, and also our shared association with the Joseph Campbell Foundation that is the foundation of our friendship and what led him to ask me if I wanted to talk to you. So
when I read your background, I see that you say you started studying myth and depth psychology 20 years ago, and you were reinventing yourself at the time and looking for options and new ways of living. You wanted to become awake and alive in this mysterious cosmos. So why don't we start there? Why don't you, as much as you're comfortable sharing, what was happening at that time that put you in that place of wanting to reinvent yourself and find a new life, and then what brought you to, in particular, to the study of myth and depth psychology at that period?
Okay. Well, when I graduated from college, I went to work as an organizer for a network of public interest organizations, and I did that for a number of years. One thing that was going on is that I was totally burnt out from that and really questioning the whole paradigm. I mean, I think that community organizing and grassroots politics are essential, but I was very aware that we were kind of playing a game in imagining that decisions were being made on the basis of facts.
Sure.
Now I would say, oh, of course, because actually what we're doing is debating mythologies. Mm. And so one thing that was happening was that I was burnt out in my first activist career and feeling like it wasn't the place for me to make change.
Okay.
Another thing that was happening was that my personal life was disintegrating.
Probably related,
and,
huh?
Yeah, related. And each of them, each one of these things fueled the other.
Sure.
So I found myself divorced and broke and unemployed and feeling like I was really in kind of a shambles. Hmm. In my early 30s, that's when all of this took place. And I started painting because I wanted to. Huh. And I'd been studying art, but I had never really attempted to make anything. And it opened up a whole new conversation with myself.
Wow.
One that circumvented my habitual inner dialogue and suggested things to me that even the therapy that I was doing couldn't reach.
Wow.
And at that same time, I got kind of interested in Carl Jung, and I read Memories, Dreams, Reflections. And I realized that he was talking about a process that involved the hands and creativity.
Yeah.
That was connected then also to mythology. So,
yeah, this is.
Oh, go
ahead. Okay, I was just going to say before we go forward with that, I mean, you bring a couple of things there that are really interesting to me. And one you just said was Jung, and this connection of the hands to creativity. And then the second and related one is this idea of the image. You know, not just any kind of creativity, but creativity that one immerses themselves in painting. has a profound mythological import. This notion of the image speaking directly to the soul. Campbell's notion of following your bliss. When you talk about you started painting because you wanted to, just doing something purely for yourself, some sort of radical self-care at a time when so much was in turmoil for you. I mean, just that alone is very empowering.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, so go on. Yeah, that's fascinating.
Well, so I decided to go to art school for a year and really take the act of painting seriously. And then I moved to New Mexico. I moved to this little place with no heat in the Sandia Mountains outside of Albuquerque, and started painting and got a job as a baker and just whatever I had to do. And how this all fits in with the original starting point that you provided me is what I was doing at the time was reevaluating everything that I had been told about how my life had to be and what I needed to do. And the deeper that I went into that, the more that I realized that as a pretty intelligent, achievement-oriented, middle-class American, I just started off with the assumption that I was going to go to college, and then I was going to get a job, and then I was going to have a career, I was going to work for somebody else, I was going to get married, have children, all of this stuff. And that the reality of it is a lot of that didn't have anything to do with me.
Right,
and this,
right.
And this kind of ties back into how Campbell talks about mythology.
Sure.
So we might circle back around to that.
Absolutely.
But as a result of studying, of painting and then studying Native American art, I started reading Native American mythology. And one evening, I was picked up Frank Waters' Book of the Hopi.
Mm-hmm.
And in the opening pages, he describes the people who are still living on the mesa. That's the original place that those people emerged and were sent to live, and are the place where people are still conducting the rituals that they have been conducting for hundreds of years at least. And when I read that, all of a sudden I thought, you know, there's a part of me that wants to dismiss this. And that's a mistake, because I really don't know. For all I know, this band of Hopis on the hill really are instrumental to keeping this world that I'm living in, completely unconscious of them. They're keeping it going.
Yeah.
And that was really when I started getting seriously interested in mythology, not as something to believe in, but as a way to investigate my own perspectives on the world and to continue questioning what I had been handed by the culture.
Yeah, it's fascinating. I'm reminded of the challenge. One of the groups I belong to is a group called the Society for the Anthropology of Consciousness, and it's a group of it's an academic group of anthropologists that's a subset of the American Association of Anthropologists. And the group was really formed as a in response to the challenge that Carlos Castaneda threw out to the academic world. And we can probably spend the rest of the hour talking about Castaneda and the cult that ended up, you know, sort of coming up around him and all of the problems with his quote unquote research that emerged later. But in the first couple of books, especially the question that he threw down that I think is very fascinating is one that anthropologists and those who study myth and folks like Campbell really brought to the table, which is, can you study something, can you really understand something purely by sitting outside of a community, having, you know, in your tent and having people come out one at a time and tell you stories, and then you write them down in your journal and then publish them all in your book, and then you have this some sort of collected works of the Hopi? Or do you have to somewhat live the experience? This is what the romantic poets talked about as well, that there are certain truths that can't be communicated other than through direct experience. And I think myth brings us right to the very edge of that thing, that chronicling these stories, reading them from the outside, going through a kind of rationalization or intellectual process with them is one thing, but to really live them, when you ask the question in your work on your website that comes from Jung, what myth am I living? I think that's a profound way to talk about myths, is these are things that are lived and experienced. And so, you know, when you had that realization and started studying, you know, native myths and the Hopi, what happened next?
Well, not long after that, I realized that I was never going to feel at home, really, in New Mexico. There are just layers and layers and layers and layers of culture there. And California, in contrast, is a place anybody can be from.
Right.
You know, and so I moved back to California. And at the time, I was once again broke. This is a through line in my personal story. and so I went back to work for the public interest organizations that I had been working for, but I did it part-time-ish so that I could keep painting and I could keep spending a lot of time outside, because backpacking was another real lifeline for me and place of connection where I really came into contact with who I was in the world and the world itself, which is another place that mythology is important to all of this. But so I did that for a couple of years, and then I left again. And eventually, right as I was contemplating turning 40, I had another one of these moments where I looked at my life and went, okay, I'm single, childless, unemployed, no apartment, I can do whatever I want. What do I want to do? And just out of the blue, I had two realizations. One was to move to Joshua Tree. I have a particular affinity for the desert.
Wow, okay.
And the other was to go to graduate school in some, you know, Jungian depth psychological thing.
Okay.
Is how precisely I put it to a friend of mine. And this friend said, oh, well, I've been introducing you to people who graduated from Pacifica Graduate Institute for years. And of course, I had never really paid attention to that because I just really wasn't ready, I guess.
We don't see until we're ready to, right?
Exactly. And I went into it thinking that I would get some kind of a credential that would lead to obvious employment. So I started off investigating Pacifica thinking I would get a master's degree in counseling or something like that. And back then, they were still mailing out paper catalogs.
Oh, wow.
And this was 2001. And I read the first program, which was the master's in counseling, and I thought, oh, this sounds interesting. And then I kept reading each one of the programs, and the very last one at the end was a PhD in mythology and depth psychology in a program that James Hillman and some other names that I recognized had been instrumental in kind of creating. And I wrote on the top of the page, I have no idea what I'll do with this, so this is the degree I will get.
Yeah, this is by far the most interesting one and the one that leads to no discernible employment whatsoever.
Exactly.
Yeah. Wow.
And I'm living with the consequences of that decision and also enjoying the fruits of it.
Yeah.
Which is that I'm in this incredibly interesting, inexhaustible field.
Right.
Which is exactly where I like to be.
We just had recently, a few weeks ago, we had Kelly Carlin on the program, and she finished a degree in depth psychology in mythological studies. I think just the MA at Pacifica. This was George Carlin's daughter.
Yeah.
And just speaks incredibly highly of it. And the Demeter and Persephone myth was incredibly healing for her. And is a real template for a lot of what she does now. And it helped her deal a lot with a lot of the fallout in her life around the tragic relationship she had with her own mother. So we got to speak a lot about that, about myth, not only as something helping her write her story presently and going forward, but helping her give some kind of context and form to her life before. And so did you find that for yourself as well? As you went through this program, you were able to integrate those earlier versions of yourself? Because it's so easy for us to think of those hinge points in our lives as failures. Oh God, in my 30s, everything fell apart, and I had failed in my marriage. I had failed in, and I actually don't know if you use that language, but I know a lot of people do language it that way. But I think when you can get, your story into some kind of pattern, some kind of hero's journey, some kind of mythic construct, then you see that, maybe those earlier incarnations weren't failures. They were just stages in this process of your own becoming.
Right. Yes. Stages in the process of your own becoming. Right. And also part of a conversation with the culture.
Mm-hmm.
I started off my rather lengthy explication here of how I ended up being a mythologist saying that I left to put my work in public interest.
Okay.
In part because I didn't lose confidence in the method, but felt that that wasn't going to be the only way to make change.
Right.
And so I just want to circle back to that.
Please.
Because it's important for me. It's one of the reasons that mythology is important is because it allows you to question the dominant ideas and values.
Right.
And I started off thinking about that in terms of how you make social change.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely over all of the years that I have managed not to succeed the way that my high school friends thought I would, I've had to think about my own life in terms of its own inner dynamic rather than how I measure up.
Right.
And mythology is very valuable for that.
Go ahead, finish.
They're both. It's both. I guess what I'm saying is that if you want to use mythology can provide you with a larger context for seeing your life. I think it's important to do that within an even larger framework, which is what's your cultural moment.
Right.
And I think that's important because as this idea of personal mythology gets more popular and a lot more people are using it, it's important to keep that from becoming yet another place where we can, how do I put this? We don't want to just use that as yet a new and novel way to further our self-absorption.
Right. Yeah, kind of consumerist model to mythological study or understanding.
Right. And most people who do it, or certainly someone who studies it at the level of Kelly Carlin, which is how you brought this into the conversation.
Sure.
Isn't doing that.
Right, right.
You can't study it at that level and get stuck there, I don't think.
I do think it's fascinating, though, yeah, because, one of the things Joseph Campbell said is that myth is supposed to be a mirror for the ego, and so it's supposed to kind of keep it in check, right? But if it's not doing that, and maybe you can speak more to this idea, of the development of personal mythology, maybe even define that for our audience, because I know that when people think of a myth, they'll think of a Hopi story or the Jewish creation myth, and these are narratives. And when I spoke with Bob Walter recently, and I was telling him that for me, myths are transformations that have been narratized, and so these myths give collective identity and help people understand their position within, like you said, a cultural moment or a religious tribe, and their identity sort of comes from and flows back into that larger collective entity. But in the era of personal mythology, this is a very American thing in a lot of ways. We're asking people to chart their own course and generate a mythological system that speaks sometimes only to them or a few other group of people in the world. So can you speak to the development of that a little bit?
Well, I like your definition of myth. I But I would say, first off, that the idea that a personal myth is purely personal is the first mistake.
Okay.
It's not.
Good.
We are all participating in a multi-layered mythological context.
Okay.
So the value of exploring personal mythology isn't so much to refine the particulars of your story as it is to develop a new set of insights and appreciation for them by seeing them in a larger mythological backdrop.
Gotcha.
So this is just a little fragment kind of example, but for my own life. So the desert, why do I live in the desert?
You know, yeah, I was going to return to that. So that's great. Go ahead.
The very first time I came out here, I had this strong sense that I needed to live out here at some point. And that was ridiculous, especially back then, because I was still doing my public interest work. Mm-hmm. There wasn't the internet and all of these other things. And there was even less here then than there is now. And it took me some number of years to make it happen. Well, it's not a very easy place to do the kind of work that I'm doing, just because there aren't a lot of people out here.
Right, right.
The people who are here are primarily creative people of one sort or another. So it's a great audience, but it's a relatively small one. Well, I've come to look at my place here in the desert and also the meandering path that I took to get here and all of the years that I've spent living on one or another cultural edge.
Right.
As being similar to the myth of the wandering prophet or the monk or the seeker.
Hmm.
You know, that the desert is where a lot of those kinds of people end up.
Yeah.
If you're looking for revelation, if you're looking for an opportunity to reflect, if you're looking for the ultimate mirror, then the desert's a great place to go and look for it.
Yeah, it's always the archetype is it's a vision producing place, right? It's where one goes for real connection to the mysterious and the transcendent.
Right.
And deep inner work frequently, because it's this idea of, from a yogic sense, of stripping away all excess and stripping things down to their bare essentials, and no terrain reads that more than the desert does, for sure.
Right. Right.
Fascinating. One more question for you before we go to our break. And then in the second part, I want to talk to you about the professional storytelling. I have a bunch of questions about Mythic Mojo and the work you do and how people can get access to it.
Okay.
But when you were at Pacifica, I'm really interested, and I'll preface this question with a brief anecdote, because it kind of ties into your work on art, your art conversation we had earlier. I wrote an article a couple of years ago about the art, Paleolithic cave art in the Chauvet Cave in southern France, part of that cave network. And, when the Herzog movie came out, Cave of Forgotten Dreams, I was captivated by the art, but dismayed at the sort of underinterpretation that seemed to exist in a lot of the scholarship. And I was completely blown away by the art for a couple of reasons. And one was that it comes from a time before we had differentiated that much as a species. And so there were some loose tribal affiliations by, 30,000 BC, but there weren't Germans and French and Canadians. There weren't Jews and Christians and Muslims, right? That we were basically at that point still just humans. And so the art is a part of a mythological heritage that is not differentiated yet. It genuinely belongs to all people on the planet as a part of their collective mythological heritage. And it's not long after that where things start to diverge. and become, you know, centralized in one culture or another. The other thing that fascinated me about the art and about the time period is that the, you know, and a lot has been written on this, but the clear partnership relationship that exists there, not only to other species and other animals of in the biota, but among genders, right? And this leads me to my question for you about myth and gender and myth and human sexuality, in particular feminism, because at Pacifica, you know, the Campbell Library exists there, but somebody else's library is there as well, and that's is Maria Gimbutas. And I just wondered what your relationship was. You talked about doing activism at first. What your relationship is and understanding is, and this is a long question, sorry, of myth as transformative in terms of women's empowerment and bringing a message to women of this country and of the world that mythology is not patriarchal in essence, but that holds many, many truths and many and much wisdom for women, especially marginalized women, to find themselves and find a power that they may have been separate from because of cultural conditions. Can you hear the question in there? What was your relationship? Did any of did you resonate with any of that when you were a student there?
Yeah, I'm not sure. We'll see. I'll dive in here, but
sure, please.
There's a lot.
This might be one of those things we have to cut out later, but it's not your fault.
there's a lot going on there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Help me here. Help me.
Well, so gender. Feminist agendas, women, and myth.
Yes. In 3 minutes or less.
First of all, a lot of mythology, what we think of as being mythology, and a lot of that is, and that includes what we think of as religions.
Mm-hmm.
So Christianity, for example, is a biggie here in the United States, along with the Greeks. Those are probably our primary mythological foundations,
yeah,
though.
I would say that's fair.
There are lots of other things going on here. Those are patriarchal systems.
Mm-hmm. So, little bit.
Yeah. So one thing that I think that's important to do if you are concerned about women's empowerment and the feminist agenda, to for lack of a better word,
mm-hmm.
is to admit and recognize that.
Yeah.
But see, as soon as you do that, for me, it's like questioning any other value that's embedded in a myth. Because mythologies are always more than what the user intends.
Yeah.
They're open. So you're free to reject what you don't like in terms of the values that it conveys, and also then continue to work with the story and the images and the metaphors there to uncover something that does.
Yeah, you know what's really a really interesting example of that is in Hindu mythology, actually, in the two great Hindu epics, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, and in the Ramayana, the story of Prince Rama and his wife Sita, who and in this classic story, and this quickly for the audience who doesn't know it, basically it's a story that's intended to sort of teach women what their dharma is, which is this sort of undying devotion to their husband, including this notion of committing sati, that if the husband dies first, the most honorable thing for a woman is to throw herself on the funeral pyre and just to stay devoted to her husband regardless of what he does. And so it's a rather tragic story from my perspective when you read Sita's undying devotion to Rama, and he continues to dispel her from the palace and make her live in the woods because he's convinced she cheated on him when she didn't. And in the end, she's swallowed up by the earth in her kind of in her final sort of statement of devotion to him. And so for years and years and years, this was presented kind of like Jews and Christians give Proverbs 30, chapter 30, I believe it is, to women at marriage as a kind of here's the list of things you will now do, right? And so a lot of folks really saw this as a kind of conscripted and limiting view of what a woman's role is in Hinduism. And but it was seen as that forever. But a lot of women teachers and a lot of women yogis and spiritualists in India over the past 20, 30 years have stepped away from this and have kind of, and they embrace the story still, but they say, hey, you know, reading this as a kind of template for how all women should act is a application of this myth that we reject. But what this myth is saying is that anything a woman chooses to do, she should do with her full self and with integrity and with as much authenticity as possible. And so they're kind of rebranding the interpretation of the myth, not the myth itself. It's as relevant as it ever has been, but it means something different to them now. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yes, yes. And that rebranding could also include a total rejection. Mm. I would go that far.
Okay.
Also. When you see something as a myth, the way that I work with mythology, it immediately gives you permission that doctrines, dogmas, orthodoxy, ideologies, religions, all these other don't necessarily, which is to reinterpret, to question the value system that's there. And also, when you make a move to myth, you're making a really, you're acknowledging that we are constructing, and not even constructing as reasonably and rationally, but constructing imaginatively our realities and social systems. And not only are we using our imagination as opposed to reason by and large, but we are poetically engaged with something that's larger than us. And this is where the depth psychology comes in.
That's fascinating. Go ahead.
Yeah. So when I studied, and I haven't developed my expertise in this area a whole lot, but when I studied, for example, Yoruban mythology, West Africa, and I started reading about their concept of time. And in a nutshell, you could say, here in the United States, we spend very little, we spend some time, not a lot, thinking about the past. We spend almost no time in the present, and we put all of our attentions on this projected future. But in this other system, the past is huge. The past is a huge presence, and almost everything else is devoted to the present, and the future is almost non-existent.
Right.
And as soon as you start really contemplating that and playing around with that, you see how many assumptions we operate with.
Right.
That are just a function of how the loudest voices have managed to push us.
Right, and they're just as unfounded as any of the other ones that we can criticize more freely.
Yeah. Absolutely. So I guess what I'm saying is that once you start using the paradigm of myth, not only are you allowed to really question and reinterpret and even deconstruct the myths you've been given, but you're also moving into that recognition that things are far more arbitrary than we're told.
I speak with my students. We'll go to break after this. And when we come back from break, I want to ask you, you said in a little earlier about how Joseph Campbell's understanding of myth influences you a great deal. So I want to ask you maybe to articulate what that is and how it influenced you. And then I want to get into the specific work you do and talk a little bit about myth mojos and everything else you have going on. But where are we? I just lost track of the story I was going to tell. So why don't we just go to break and I'll tell it when we get back. Does that sound good to you?
Okay. How much time do I have?
We got about another 25 minutes.
No, I mean on my break.
Oh, as long as you need.
Okay, I just need to get a glass of water. But
you got it.
Okay.
All right, folks, you're listening to On the Block Radio. Our guest is Dr. Catherine Svehla, and we will be back. Catherine Svehla, I'll get your name right. I've been butchering the guest names over the past few episodes. It's this new tick of mine. Who the hell knows where it's coming from? But whoever you are, you're doing a great job so far, and we will be right back after these words.
for listening to OTB, a digital love letter between what is and what is possible. More after this.
There once was a snake who terrorized a tiny village. He bit everyone without provocation. Men, women, children, family pets. This snake did not discriminate. He had absolutely no sensitivity. One day, a Buddhist monk came to the village, and he observed the snake's behavior. He committed himself to teaching the snake the principle of nonviolence, and he approached it with the mantra of inner peace. "You do not have to do this thing that you do," he said. And as it turned out, the snake had a penchant for self-improvement. He loved the concept of nonviolence and absorbed all of the monk's teachings wholeheartedly. Now, when people went near his nest, the snake didn't bite them. And of course, people noticed this. And alas, they exploited his newly found vulnerability. They threw dirt on him. They pelted him with rocks. They poked him with sticks and generally made the snake's life miserable. Sometime later, the monk came back to the village and he went to visit his old student. He found the snake bruised and beaten. "Why, what happened to you? Oh, it pains me to see you in such a predicament." "Alas, you taught me the principle of nonviolence. You taught me not to bite people, and this is the result." "Ah, my friend, I did teach you not to bite people, but I never said that you couldn't hiss." The basic principles and teachings of Buddhism are contained in parables like this one, and the Buddha himself used to use them in his teaching. This parable teaches us the importance of setting boundaries in the practice of nonviolence. Buddhism is a practice of compassion, and that compassion extends to yourself as well as others. Self-protection is your right. Just because you practice nonviolence doesn't mean that you let other people abuse you and take advantage of you. When you set your boundaries clearly, like a hissing snake, you make shared peace possible. Namaste.
Hi there, this is Bob Walter from the Joseph Campbell Foundation. You're listening to On the Block Radio.
right, folks, welcome back to the show. Both of us got our act, actually your host got his act together, and now I remember what I was saying before we went to break. I think I just needed a little water. So when we went to break, we were talking about this, when we step into myth, we buy ourselves a little elasticity in terms of the understanding, application, acceptance, and rejection of these things. When we step away from dogma, when we step away from our obsession with historicity. And this is a story I frequently talk to my students about in my myth and in my religion classes. I bring up the example of Jacob wrestling with the angel of the Lord. And it's actually when his name is changed to Israel. And I talk about this story in terms of, you know, from one kind of interpretive frame. I spent about 10 years of my life as an evangelical fundamentalist Christian pastor. And so from one frame, the way to read this story is as a bit of history, right? This actually happened, right? And if you could get on a time machine, or if you had a drone or something with a camera on it, you could fly over this event and actually witness Jacob wrestling all night on the ground with this Malach Yahweh, with this angel of the Lord figure. And I ask my students to spend some time interpreting that for me, right? Like what the significance of this event, what it might mean, right? And we come up with a list of things. I ask them to consider the story as myth, which does not mean, by the way, that it didn't happen, right? Calling something a myth, it does not mean that it does not have any historical root. Some myths claim to be completely historical. Some myths claim to not be historical at all, and anything in between. But when we look at the story of Jacob wrestling with God as a metaphor, as myth, suddenly the story opens up to us, and all of this imagery and all of this complexity emerges, where one has multiple access points. What does it mean to wrestle with God? What does it mean to wrestle against God? What does it mean to wrestle alongside of God? Right, on the part of righteousness or goodness in the world? What does it mean to struggle with our higher self? What does it mean to struggle with our own base impulses and our own fear? You know what I mean? There's a lot, you know, anytime you come back to this story at any point in your life, there's another layer of significance there for you to step into and to experience. By the way, including the conversation we were having about what it means to read the story about wrestling with God. That's part of the struggle of interacting with that myth as well. And the students really get it then. And by the way, even the students who believe that the story, quote unquote, really happened, when they want to access the meaning part, when they want to access saying anything about it in terms of its application to their lives, they have to go step over into metaphor and myth as well. Even folks who believe in the sort of historicity of it. So is that kind of what you were saying a bit ago?
Yes. And I love that you use this example of Jacob because one of my favorite poems is Rilke's poem, The Man Watching.
Hmm.
I don't know if you're familiar with that poem or not, but in one of the final stanzas, he makes a move towards invoking the angel.
Hmm.
And it's Jacob's angel. And he raises the possibility that the angel might decline the fight. So you can add that to your list of things to consider. Yes.
That is fascinating.
And for Rilke, you know, it's an opportunity to meditate on what we choose to fight.
Right.
You know, where our ambitions are and the hugeness of the real challenges and mysteries in life.
But, boy, that's fascinating.
But yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about. And there are many definitions of myth. I mean, it's one of the trickiest words we've got, but that revolve around its connection to meaning.
Hmm. I have a question for you before we get into, I want to ask about Mythic Mojo and about your podcast and the work you do with people and how people can access your storytelling and other services. And when we post this episode, we'll have all of that info on our site as well, but I want to ask you a bit about it. But in your materials that I was looking and prepping for this interview, I found a great line. You say, cats, homegrown tomatoes, the glide of a paintbrush across paper have saved your life. and walking, lots of walking. And then a little bit further down, you say, you talk about the desert being your home, which may explain a lot of your wandering. And so I guess, you know, as a mythologist, as a storyteller, and just in your own life, how important has wandering and walking been to you?
Essential.
Go ahead.
How do I put this? I very rarely get a good idea unless I'm walking.
Isn't that true?
I really refined that when I was in graduate school, but it became my routine was to go for a walk in the morning. I would then figure out the solutions to whatever I was blocked on if I was writing, or get the idea. I basically get the information, the material that I was going to work with then the rest of the day. But before any of that, walking for me is a way of reconnecting with the larger reality.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's all this activity that's going on inside, but it also reminds me that I'm one puny little individual in this amazing web of life. And whatever it is I think I'm doing is only what I think I'm doing
right
now. And, I have known people over the years who found this type of thinking really threatening. But for me, it's very energizing and life-affirming. I have a friend who used to come out and visit me in the desert a lot, and we called it puny glory. This sort of being cut down to size and elevated at the same time.
Yeah, it's remarkable. It's that mythic component that does exactly that. It makes you feel so small and so immense at the same time.
Right.
You know, when you're talking...
So when I go out...
Go ahead. When you go out...
So when I go out and I'm ruminating over something or obsessing about something, and all of a sudden an owl flies out of the rocks and across, it's like, oh, right. You know, what am I doing?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, here I am right now, right here, walking, breathing. I'm participating. So forget that, you know, be here now kind of a thing. But that's what walking does also.
I think about what you're saying, you know, there's so many access points here. Again, you know, so many scientific breakthroughs occurred when the scientists left the laboratory and just went for a walk. I think about my friend Brian Rill, who's a devotee and practitioner of Shigendo Buddhism, which is just a walking Buddhism. You walk in the hills to answer all of your deep questions. And when you have some more, you go walk some more.
Mm-hmm.
The Norse myth, there's a Norse myth in one of the Eddas about a wander off between Odin and Thor. They challenge each other to who can wander better. And they're going to wander for like 1,000 years and then show back up and tell each other the stories of what they bumped into while they were wandering and see who tells better stories. Right. And so it's a wander off between these two gods. And I'm fascinated by this because in a kind of materialist culture, in a consumer-based culture that looks at time with regard to productivity, you know, then we get into this shortest distance between two things is a straight line. Everything becomes about increasing efficiencies, especially in the technological world. I was just reading an article recently about how, you know, mindfulness in the corporate world has been co-opted to try to just make workers more complicit, work harder for less, and to not complain about it, as opposed to, you know, trying to help improve their lives or whatever. And so, this notion of walking and wandering, not only as something that's good for the self and for the body, and for the soul, this has, you know, large mythic import in terms of, you know, across the world. You know, Aboriginals go on walkabout when they want to discover something. And lastly, what I think about is Central Park. I don't know if you know this, but the designers of Central Park, it was a guy named Frederick Olmsted. His grandson is a friend of mine, and he was telling me that Olmsted was an interesting guy because he very much believed this that you and I were talking about and that we're talking about here, and wanted to design public space with an awareness of this. And so he also designed, I think, Forest Park here in Portland, and he didn't put a single straight line in Central Park in terms of the pathways, because he didn't want people to use the public space just as a way to get from point A to point B. He wanted them to wander when they walked through it, because he thought it would fundamentally change their experience of being in that natural environment. And so I think there's a lot to this, to the sort of meditation of walking and connecting it to accessing deeper wisdom within the self.
I agree, absolutely. Hmm. And the efficiency, productivity, straight line method that we haven't even started talking about, the cultural myths that are controlling us right now that are just assumed to be reality.
Yeah, well, go ahead. Maybe speak a bit to that for a second, and then I want to ask you about your views on Joseph Campbell, and we'll finish up talking about Mythic Mojo and the work you do.
Well, in a nutshell, every time I pick up the newspaper and I read a debate about an important issue, like why there are so many hungry people in the United States,
right,
if we're the richest country, why so many homeless, blah, blah, blah. And the answer is, well, it would hurt the economy.
Right.
Then I think, what the hell is the economy? It's a tool.
Right.
That's become a god.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in service to it. It's taking up our attention and our energy, and it's requiring us to sacrifice almost everything that makes life worth living.
Yeah, like, that Chicago School of Economics really does treat it as a religion and as a kind of grand cosmic mystery, and that it's, you know, things like human suffering or dirty water and air. These are literally called externalities when you're talking about mm-hmm. economic decisions. California was just in a drought, a very serious one. And when you say, like, you know, is it a good use of water, you know, to have an NFL game or golf courses or these things, and people say you can't stop that because of the economy, like, how many jobs would you lose if we didn't have NFL games? And it's like, well, everyone in the state's going to die if you have no more water.
Right.
But it's unthinkable to stop. No one says, you know, make cuts elsewhere. Don't mess with our economic engine over here. It's really, really quite bizarre.
Right. So part of what I hope I'm contributing to mm-hmm. in some small way is the awareness that mythology and myths don't just belong to the past.
Right.
We're making them. We're doing it now. We can't not do it.
Hmm.
And if we, going back to our conversation about women and feminism, if we start questioning from that perspective, all of these big ideas that are running our lives, then right away you see how arbitrary they are.
Yeah. Encoded to serve certain things and not others.
Right, right. Hmm. I mean, we could completely rethink the whole thing. And the reason that we don't, in my mind, is because the vast majority of us are taking what are essentially constructs as a given reality.
Hmm. Yeah, we just had Douglas Rushkoff on the show, and he talked about how he meets all of these Silicon Valley tech people, and they have all of these innovative ideas for technology and for how to change the world and for, you know, and for their business and for their company, and they have, for all of the innovation that they have for the technology, they're still operating with the same economic mindset, and they don't even realize that part of what needs to be re-envisioned is not just new ways to use this old economic machine, but that we have to actually re-envision the machine itself. And when you talk that way, you said they stand and they scratch their head and look at them because they're swimming in that water and they don't mm-hmm. realize they're swimming in that water, right? They don't mm-hmm. realize that's the air they're breathing. They just take it as a given, as this is the way it's always been. This is the way it always will be. Our friend Chris Ryan, he bangs his head against the wall always when people talk about that, when they talk about, oh, you know, we've always had war, or men have always been in charge. And when people say, you know, this has always been the way, usually what they mean is, you know, for the last couple of generations, or for, you know, since the dawn of our particular cultural paradigm. But Margaret Mead pointed out years ago that even warfare is not something that's ubiquitous across all cultures, even in the modern world, let alone millennia ago.
Right. Well,
tell us about, you know, we only have a little bit of time left, I want to ask you a few things. First, let's start with something you brought up in the first segment about your views of Joseph Campbell's views of mythology and how they are influential to you. Campbell's a very influential person for me and my work in this program, so I'd love to hear that from you.
Well, one of the most valuable things I think Campbell did was demonstrate what we're talking about here, that mythology is alive, that we're doing it, using it. And he was particularly focused, I think, in the functions of mythology as a place, as a set of guideposts for people. And, you know, that led, obviously, to one of his most famous contributions, the trajectory of the hero's journey. But so that's important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a little bit.
Another thing, though, that that Campbell talked about a lot that I find particularly interesting has to do with the role of the artist. There are people in my field now who are looking at a lot of what we call mythologies and saying these are completely dysfunctional and we need something new.
Right.
I'm totally down for that. That's part of what I'm trying to figure out. Mm-hmm. But some number of them think that we can create new mythologies.
Out of whole cloth, you know, yeah.
Yeah, consciously go, well, we should have a story that says this, that, and the other thing.
Right,
and
right.
I think we can do that.
Yeah, I think I'm with you.
And so then I'm interested in, well, if we can't create it, but we are in a unique moment in time. And by that, I mean, I think now we are in a place where we can be conscious of mythologies as mythologies and still use them. So we're no longer absolutely have to believe them and don't see them. No longer have to, you know, participate in this fantasy that we can just get rid of them.
That's fascinating.
So now we can say, okay, this is a really important capacity. In fact, it's something we can't even stop doing. So how about if we start thinking about the cornerstone of human being and human nature as this imaginative interface between this, whatever it is that's around us that we only know through our imaginative filters.
Yeah.
And our shared aspirations, the products of culture. What if we think about ourselves that way? And then where can we look for signs of new activity? Where are the new stories starting to show up? And Campbell, and he's not the only one, but he you know, is eloquent on any topic that he took up. Talks about the artist being the one who is the first to sense what's coming, mythologically speaking. And then artists are the ones who are continually conditioning our imagination.
Yeah, that's really fascinating. Well, you say a lot there, but a couple of things that I really resonate with. You know, Campbell, you know, did say that at least from his perspective, that we don't create these things, that they show up fully formed from the subconscious. And how that is a very complicated thing. I'm reminded of many of the first century early church fathers would say these inscrutable kinds of things, like I believe it was Irenaeus that said, of course God is real, he just doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that. Yeah, and I was on a panel discussion once for a AAA conference, and the theme of the panel was, is Joseph Campbell's work still relevant to modern anthropology? And Bob Walter from the Campbell Foundation was there, and then there was a guy there, Robert. Oh, I'm forgetting his name. But he's kind of a he's written a bunch of books on Campbell, and he's
Robert Siegel,
yeah, from Aberdeen, right? And boy, he was a kick in the pants, this guy. And he I remember he came, you know, running up to me, screaming at me at the end of the panel. And what he was upset with was something that I said about Greek myth. And he said, you know, you're one of these metaphor guys, and you think, you know, do you think people will build a Parthenon to something that they think is just a metaphor? And I said, well, I wouldn't say just a metaphor. I would, you know what I mean? And I said, you know, because his whole point was that the Greeks believed in the existence of these deities, much like Christians believe in the existence of Jesus. And don't give me any of this, you know, Persephone and Demeter is a story about, you know, seasonality and the dying of the crops and stuff, that they believed this was a real story about a real woman and a real daughter. And it was, you know, I'm paraphrasing his argument, but that was a, that was a bit of his argument. And I found that interesting because, to me, yes, we've been building Parthenons to metaphors, you know, or some version of that for most of our existence. And this is through art, right? Does the artist create the image or intuit the image or represent the image? And that's a very complicated question to get answered. I just I was fortunate enough to work on a book project with the Campbell Foundation on Indonesian tribal art. And the point we, Bob and I wrote the introduction for it, and the point we were trying to get across for these folks who were presenting this amazing collection of Indonesian art was this exact thing, this point that Campbell was trying to make about the artists of any culture are going to be the arbiters of what's happening in that culture on many levels, not only mythologically and symbolically, but scientifically as well. There's that great book by Leonard Schlein, Art and Physics, that makes the same point.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, that's really fascinating.
Right.
In our final minutes, I want to ask you about your work, about maybe start with Mythic Mojo. Tell us about this.
Okay. Well, so Mythic Mojo is ever-evolving, but Mythic Mojo is a place where people can come and contact me about speaking on topics like this. And it's also a place where people can contact me to do various forms of mythological consulting. So that can be either you're writing a book and you want to use mythological themes and you want advice on how to do that.
Very cool.
Or where you may be going astray. And it can also be personal myth.
Yeah, because you have the depth psychology background, too. So I saw that you do some great stuff on mythic patterning and things like that.
Yeah, mythic pattern reading. So that is a one-on-one process. It's similar to getting your astrological chart done, but I have a lot more questions for you than what's your birthday.
Yeah, what time of day, right.
Yeah. And a lot of people who approach me about that are wanting to understand either what their life's been about. They want to get a sense of what their contributions have been, or they feel like they're caught in an internal tension or contradiction.
Oh, I gotcha.
And they want a way of thinking about it that can help them bounce out of it. So that's Mythic Mojo. And then Myth in the Mojave.
Myth in the Mojave was my next question. So yeah, what's that?
Myth in the Mojave, my podcast that I'm doing, they're 30-minute podcasts, and they're, for better or for worse, they're almost all just me talking. But I tell stories in many of them, and then I work with them along the lines of what we've been talking about here.
Okay.
So if anybody who's listening to this program wanted to go and pick a story and find out how you might relate that to your personal life or to the culture, you'd find that in those podcasts.
And that's great. And those are half-hour bits, and so people can consume those, you know, on the way to work or when they're out, you know, in traffic or something. It's a great way to kind of redeem the time.
Right.
Very cool.
I mean, right now I've been working for the last, I think the program I just finished was maybe the fifth, on the topic of Titanism and the Titans. So
yeah, so tell us how that would go. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I got interested in that story in 2008 when I was thinking about Obama. Mm-hmm. and that election. Because the Titans, almost all of their story is involved with a war that they fought with the Olympians called the Titanomachia.
Uh-huh.
And so it's a story about a major shift in world order, a cultural sea change.
Right.
And when I started looking at the story, there were a few things about it that really interested me. One was the role of the earth in looking for champions and being really the catalyst for these big changes. Right at the moment, I'm thinking about the earthquake that just happened in Italy.
Yeah, my goodness.
And then the tipping point in that war was the retrieval of three brothers who'd been repressed to the underworld, which then raises the question for me of, well, what are the three repressed brothers for us now?
Right.
If, in fact, this story is a model. Well, I went back to that story in this current presidential election because the Titans and what they represent as the excessive, mm-hmm. unbounded, violent, and ultimately vacuous,
yeah.
seemed very relevant.
Oh, boy.
And,
just leave it at that, huh?
yeah. And that led me to look into some of James Hillman's thinking about the difference between the Titans and the Olympians.
Hmm.
In a nutshell, the difference being that the Titans are empty, that is, unimaged, and that what Zeus and the Olympians represent is a differentiated imagination.
Huh.
It's well populated. You know, we have all of these characters, all these varied and well-developed personifications of different ways of being. And so I've been playing around with the things that I got out of this Hillman essay, and this is, you know, the short version in this
sure.
series of programs, to offer ways that people can think about how they're experiencing the Titanic right now, how that is a producer of a lot of the stress and also just the general numbness that many of us are feeling, how you can combat that effect through using your imagination to reconnect with the world, to basically populate that empty space of the Titanic in your own little corner of the world, in your own psyche. So that's what I've been talking about on Myth in the Mojave. And that's a good example, I hope, of the themes that I am always trying to work. You know, I want to encourage individual people in their thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm overall, on a larger level, I'm interested in finding cracks in the cultural mythologies that are killing us right now, basically. And using as the tool to do that, the myths we've been given.
Yeah.
That we see, the stories we see as mythologies.
I think that's really powerful. Thank you for taking some time with us. You know, at the end, in your site, I love what you say, that you want to help people explore the mythic dimension of their own lives and follow their bliss and help them start a mini revolution in consciousness. And just to, at the end here, return to what you were saying in the beginning, you know, I kind of see you as still doing that transformative activist work, but the two differences are, it's not so much prescriptive as descriptive now, and you're going a person at a time as opposed to trying to move whole groups at once, but you're still pushing for that revolution in consciousness. You're just maybe a guide now for people to initiate that within themselves.
Right. Yes. Thank you for that.
Yeah. Wonderful. Yes. Catherine, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me. I've really enjoyed this.
Yeah, folks are always surprised. I don't know what that means. Wow, that was actually fun. And folks can if they want to contact you and hear that podcast and subscribe to it, if they want to connect with your work, then the best place is the mythicmojo.com?
Mythicmojo.com, yes. But there is also a website for mythinthemojave.com.
Okay.
And that's a little more direct. There are always a couple of sample programs posted on that website, and there's a gateway then also to the archives. I have recently finished my 100th original episode.
Hmm. Wow.
And those are archived on Bandcamp.
Okay, yeah, I saw you on Bandcamp as well. And also, lastly, you're a professional storyteller, right? So you do events and professional storytelling out for folks as well, correct?
Yes, I do. I do. I originally became familiar with the Joseph Campbell Foundation and Robert Walter. You've mentioned him several mm-hmm, times because mm-hmm. I had a round table out here in Joshua Tree for 6 years.
Oh, okay.
Where I told stories and talked about them, essentially did an extended version of what I'm doing now in my podcast. But I still speak out here. I'm teaching a course on the functions of mythology in contemporary life at the local community college.
Wonderful.
I speak at the Ace Hotel down in Palm Springs every couple of months, you know, that type of thing.
Yeah.
So basically anybody who wants to hear a story and be given a way to think about it.
That is fantastic.
Not the meaning of the story, but a way to think about it. Should contact me.
I met the person who connected us, you and I originally, David Gonzalez. We were speaking about him, and I met him originally at the Esalen Institute, and he was there in that capacity, and he was, I think, working with the Campbell Foundation, and I saw him perform his version of the Orpheus tale, and it was just spectacular.
Yeah, he's great. I met him very recently, but mm-hmm. it just so happened that it was, you know, a couple of months before a performance of Orpheus that he was doing in Palm Springs.
Hmm.
And so my husband and I and some other mutual friends, which is how we met David, all went down there, and I was really, really impressed. It was just wonderful.
Well, what's great, and well, I guess we'll leave it at this, like you said in the beginning, there's a lot of, some of the listeners might not have even come across this kind of performance of professional storytelling, as you're saying, but there's a lot of diversity there, and there's a lot of folks that bring a lot of different approaches to the table. And so even where there might be some overlap with you and David, there's also a lot of really unique things that you would bring to a performance that David doesn't do or would do differently. And so folks need
right.
to definitely get over and check out your work. Well, thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate it. Is there anything you want to say at the end here that we didn't cover?
No, I think that's it. I guess the one thing that I would say that I'd add is my favorite quote from James Hillman, who we really didn't get a chance to talk about.
At all, yeah.
At all. My favorite quote of all the many amazingly wonderful and insightful things that he said was, "The way that we imagine our lives is the way that we will live them."
Hmm.
And that's in a nutshell, would be why I am a mythologist and why I am teaching and talking about mythology the way that I am.
Wow, that wraps it up.
As a way to get ideas.
I'd love to have you back on and talk more about James and his influence on you and on mythology and on depth psychology. That would be fantastic sometime.
Sure, I'd love to.
All right, folks, our guest has been Dr. Catherine Svehla. Did I get it right? Svehla. I'm telling you, it's this new tick of mine. It's never. I'm going to have a guy named Joe Smith on next week, and I'll fuck up his name, too. I'm telling you. My name is. Go ahead.
I can hear it now.
Yeah. Like you said.
Joey Smite.
Right. Like I said, we got that editing button that we never use, so we'll see. You've been listening to On the Block Radio, folks. This is your host, Andy Gervich, and we will see you on the other side.
And you're listening to On the Block Radio with Andy Gervich.
used to go around with Creator. Everywhere the Creator went, Dog followed. When the Creator had a job to do, the dog watched him. And when he was finished, the dog followed him to the next place. One day, Dog said, "Grandfather, will you always be here? Or will you sometimes have to go away?" "Well," said Grandfather Creator, "perhaps a day will come when I have to go far away." "Oh, Grandfather," said the dog, "will you make me a companion then?" "Okay," said Grandfather, and he laid down on the ground. "Come over here," he said to the dog, "and take your paw and trace an outline around me." Dog did this. Grandfather Creator got up and looked. "That's pretty good," he said. "Now you go off a little ways and don't watch." So Dog went off a little ways and he sat down and waited. And after just a little while, he looked. "Oh, Grandfather," he said, "there's somebody lying there where you were lying." "Now, I told you not to look," said Grandfather Creator. "You go off a little bit further and don't watch." Dog went off a little bit further and he waited. And after a little while, he looked. "Oh, Grandfather," he said, "there's something moving over where you were lying." "Now, I told you not to look," said Grandfather Creator. "You go off a little ways and don't watch. You wait until I tell you." So Dog went off a little further, and he waited. And finally, the Creator called him. "Come over. You can come over and look now." The dog came over to where Grandfather was, and they both looked down at the man. "Pretty good," said Creator. "Oh, I think he's wonderful," said the dog. Creator bent down and lifted the man up by the shoulders and stood him on his feet. "Walk," Creator said. And he moved the man's foot, and the man walked. "Now talk," Creator said. But the man said nothing. 4 times, the Creator asked the man to speak. "Say words," he said. And at last, the man spoke. "Now yell," said Creator. And he shouted. And the man shouted back. "What else?" the man asked. Creator thought for a minute. "Laugh," he said. "Laugh," and he laughed. And the man laughed and laughed and laughed. And when the man laughed, the dog was so delighted that he ran up and jumped on him. And ran around the man in circles and jumped on him again, the way that dogs still do today when they are filled with joy and love and delight. "Ah," said the Creator, "now you are fit to live." And the man walked off with the dog.
You've been listening to On the Block Radio with Andrew Gurevich. The show is produced in Portland, Oregon by Michael DiNapoli at MD Productions. Theme music by Moving the Mountain. closing music by Jonathan Oak. Look us up on the web at ontheblockradio.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't forget to tune in next week for a brand new episode. Previous episodes can be found on our website. Thanks for listening.
Are you beautiful kitty kitties? Oh, look at you out there. Beauty like a bolt, light in a darkened hallway. New minds looking at this world, at our lives, through the perspective of apocalypse children. Standing dusty in the barren highways, standing broken before the fathers who are meant to make us whole, but who only lied to us about what it meant to be a man, about what it meant to be a woman, about what it meant to be a child of this doomed age.